Continuing with our panel discussion, I mean, we have quite an interesting set of panelists available on the dais, from large IPPs to legal counsels supporting financing and strategic and or institutional investors, from large investors like SoftBank and providing insights on how the entire supply and value chain works, to transactions and transaction advisory or investment banking. And so I think it's a mix of whole setup what could cover the entire ecosystem towards finding out what's correct, what's wrong, and if it is wrong, how can we correct what it is presently wrong. We've touched upon few things like in the inaugural session keynote address on how the plant qualities and they are being sacrificed at the cost of lower tariff. We've also touched upon technology and manufacturing landscape in India. But I would say if any one of you during the panel discussion want to touch upon a couple of things, which we've already achieved 30 gigawatt by now when we are sitting here for solar. Having a target of 175 for the renewable energy, there are reports which says we may miss that by 55 gigawatt and not be able to achieve. But if at all financing is a problem in infrastructure, there are only two sectors which have seen in recent past, roads and renewable. So will it continue? Will renewable projects be in smooth sail like the way they were, or the impact on the NBFC crisis could impact getting funding on time, and also, you know, not only for project finance but maybe a little bit of corporate finance. And if Mitesh wants to cover that again during the panel discussion, then how has been the experience also on for some of the players on the equity side outside debt. We'll also see if anyone wants to, but if not then I can cover that part of it. That how the distributed energy sector has been. We have a target of 40 gigawatt, we are at 4 gigawatt. Even if we assume 50% CAGR, we are ending at 10 to 12 gigawatt in that. And what could be advancements in that sector, particularly given the fact the kind of challenges we are facing in the utility sector. I would also like key members of the dais from legal side to cover what are the legal and commercial issues? How is the investor interest? I mean, given the fact that, you know, some of the states have now realized that they are not able to get, even if they are putting up a bid, they are not able to get any investor interest. And now they are going to SECI saying that, particularly to our state, you only conduct the tenders because on our own, we are not able to find out any investor interest or any developers to bid for. On legal and enforcement side, how does the contracting system work? How enforceable are those contracts, PPA, payment security, what we have been speaking? Lenders are hesitant presently. Do we see a solution after 2 years? Once this NBFC crisis settles a little bit, will this continue, or some of the key players who have been funding like L&T Infra, Yes Bank, Tata Capital Cleantech on NBFC, will they continue doing that, or there could be problems? On a large IPPs, I may ask some of you to cover if there are things relating to forecasting, scheduling, monitoring of large utility plants where there are issues. And each state is coming up with tight regulations, which are presently 15%, but they are talking of making it up to 5% to see that they don't face problems in managing grid with large integration of solar and wind, this thing. And if from a wind fraternity, anyone, I'm not sure here, but want to cover on onshore and offshore wind. So this I would say could give us some perspective on how we want to take the session forward today. But let me start. I would request each one of you to limit your opening remarks to 3 to 4 points, 3 to 4 minutes, given the time we are running right now, and then we can do a little bit discussion on the points which are coming out from the opening remarks, followed by closing remarks from each of the panelists, and we'll go into the audience for question and answer, and try to give time at least for 15 minutes for Q&A. So let me start, and each of you I would request to introduce yourself. Let me start with Mr. Brajesh Gupta, CEO Artha Group, from their side, and would request if you can start with your opening remarks on that.
Hello. Good morning. Brajesh Gupta. So we are IPP. Basically, the group entered this sector for depreciation, but now we are not looking at depreciation anymore. So we are creating our own platform. We are a 400 megawatt right now, and committed again to the sector last year. We took some backstage. Looking forward again. Let's see how we can do that. Now, Kapil, thanks. You set a nice tone to discuss. The most important point is that we all are here for one thing, and that is profit. I think that's drivers. That's what brings us here. I don't think we are here for anything else. But apart from profit, it's also important to understand that you can make immediate profit on the books, on the paper, on a financial model. It's very easy. You can sell that to your investment committees, to the board of directors, get the project up. But somewhere down the line, the value creation is very important. And for value creation, there has to be a very, very conducive and a very inclusive atmosphere and a very high level of collaboration, as this sector, the power is generated, consumed, and it affects the entire 135 crore people in India and the entire population the world over. So the value creation is what creates is the bottleneck, and that is what will drive this sector. My feeling is here. I'll just tell you maybe 10-15 years back when I used to visit MSCB, integrated MSCB. So the people used to tell there, by switching on or switching off the switch for a light, people don't realize how it impacts the grid. So they say it's better to keep the switch on rather than or keep the switch off. So it's very important to understand the point of view on that basis. The important thing, Raviji spoke in the morning, is the grid. See, the earlier the power was generated at the central point, upstage to a large voltage, and then distributed to small voltage. Today, the small rooftops are generating power at 400 volts, and when they don't want it, they end up pumping into the grid. So the entire grid management, grid design, and there was a big concept in between. We used to talk about smart grid. And somewhere I don't see that smart grid word spoken too often. And that's a very collaborative, it needs a collaborative approach from the government. So the smart grid is very important, where we need to pump power from, and it's creating a chaos. The power flows like water, the path of least resistance. So the back downs, the grid failures, the evacuation, so there has to be whatever investment we are talking, 175 gigawatt, the equivalent investment has to go into grid. Then only this 175 gigawatt will be manageable, will be profitable, will have value. We lose on smart grid today, and that's, I believe, is a very important point. And it's not easy. It's a difficult industry to be, but that's very important point on that thing, basically. That's what I could like to say. There are many things I could add, but Kapil, I could put it there and let other people add it.
Sure. Thank you, Rajesh. May I now move on to Mr. Shailendra Bibotra, Managing Director, IBC Solar. IBC being a global IPP and EPC, and if you want to add from your experience within India and outside India, given the fact that they are such a large global company with big presence in Europe. So if you want to compare the Indian versus the international experience, or what are the challenges, what you face, and the possible solution you want to point out in next few minutes.
Thanks Kapil for putting it in context. I represent IBC in India. IBC is a homegrown German global company which has been in this business for the last 36 years. So perhaps it's the oldest surviving solar company in the world. In a sense, we have a track record of delivering around 4 gigawatt projects. For us, the mix is a bit different. In the sense, out of this, 3.3 is distributed generation, and 700 megawatt is ground mounted systems. We are a zero grid company, and we have been doing this business in India. As far as India is concerned, we have been here since last 5 years, and we have a small player in the Indian market.
Can't hear you.
We are a small player in the Indian market. In the sense, we have done roughly 100 megawatts of EPC. We do O&M for around 60 megawatt projects, and we have a development portfolio of 140 megawatt projects, which comprises of few commission projects and few pipelines. So having said that, as Mr. Khanna has left, but I was also at the Intersolar last week. I think there are a few broad issues that we have on hand. The first issue is that from one section of the government policymakers, we hear that India is the power surplus country right now. The peak level deficits are coming down. If that be the case, then that's not the story for any energy project. On the other side, we hear that the per capita consumption is low, as Mr. Somani has put it in his slide. This is likely to grow. But the distribution companies are not in a position to buy this power. So that's the reason that there is resistance for high cost quality solar power in the grid. So we need to find a definitive answer to that through a policy document so that all of us are at ease. Because we hear somewhere between from 100 gigawatt to 350 gigawatt is target between 2020 to 2050. So this is a large number, and that means that solar power is getting integrated to the mainstream. I mean, if you look at 2018, almost more than 50% of annual power addition was from solar. So, I mean, the second view which is coming in is that the race for these large single location plants is over, because this is putting a lot of stress on the grid. And the ultimate delivered cost to the distribution company when it reaches actually consumer's home is almost equivalent to another source. So decentralized generation and decentralized use of solar power is going to the distribution. We could see maybe once the new government comes in and we rethink the whole thing, that we modify the whole thinking process. Third thing is, it's a fairly dynamic industry in the last 4 to 5 years. Because anybody who makes a presentation for Global Board will know that by the time he approaches the Global Board with the paper, the assumptions have changed. And a lot of changes are happening at a very fast pace, which I would say that we need a bit of stability in the policy, be it in terms of safeguard duties or different regulations coming from different state regulators as well as CERCs. We need a bit of policy stability there. And finally, since we have reached this 30 gigawatt target, almost 30% of what we have planned, I think questions are now being asked about profitability. Because till now it was good. I mean, everybody was looking at a track record, market is just catching up. But now serious questions are being asked about profitability and how much money you make on your, how much money you make actually in the business. A lot of risks are not getting captured in the project calculations. For portfolio companies, they're leaving it perhaps for the public market to address in terms of their screening. But if you really allocate this to the project level, I think most of the project have a negative margin. So this has led to a situation where there is a lot of pressure on quality. I mean, at least I have seen two or three presentations in Intersolar where these photographs of Indian projects flying around or somebody's publishing, and those kind of photographs have been used internationally. So we have to be very careful from now onwards in terms of how we want to take it further. And as an EPC company, I could tell you that most of the innovative cost reduction suggestions have come from the developers, not from us. They asked us to do something which at times sounds crazy, but that's what the market demands. So we are at a very interesting time, and hopefully this forum would address most of the issues. Thanks for your time.
I like to use the word innovative. And developers adding to that innovation, I mean, at the cost of so it's not that, you know, I wouldn't agree that only EPCs are sacrificing on their margins. Maybe even developers are facing problems, and overall, maybe even whenever we meet suppliers, they say we are on the last side of the value chain, even when EPC do. So we are also on razor thin margins or negative margins, or just to maintain our survival. So, you know, this challenge is a complete ecosystem challenge where developers face a project level risk. Where, as you pointed out, at a portfolio level, maybe it is looking healthy, but at the project level, they've asked EPCs to find out solutions moving from, without doing any internal studies, moving from 50 tons a megawatt to as low as 17 or 20, and where someone else shows up pictures of flying panels or structures coming out, which is not a healthy sign for a growing sector. And at especially at international forums like Intersolar Munich. So thanks, Shailendra, for pointing out a couple of other things which were decentralized versus large, and I'll come back to you for some questions at a later date. But given that time, I would now request Karan Mitro, who's partner at Luthra & Luthra.
How are you going to enforce these contracts with the global players is going to be a huge issue, because you can choose arbitration as opposed to portfolios, which any strategic player would do. But the execution of the enforcement has to happen in that specific country. And to that extent, you need to be mindful of how exactly you're going to enforce, because you don't get guarantees for these contract enforcements typically in any contract. So assessment of module players and enforcement mechanisms within the contract have to be carefully crafted to secure yourself from the perspective of suppliers. Vis-a-vis PPAs, we've seen recent issues where SECI is trying to sort of move the entire risk to the DISCOMs. And we've seen that come in slowly in the SECI PPAs. Now, obviously, the DISCOMs are not in the healthiest of situations. And we've always believed that the renewable energy is a tripod, right? Where there's focus on generation, which is the area of interest for all of us. But we also need to focus equally on distribution and transmission, because if one of those two fails, generation has no value for you. So strengthening the DISCOMs is essential. Most of the PPAs have provisions for escrow or guarantees, but I think everyone in this room is aware that that's not very forthcoming from most of the procurers. And that is a huge credit risk, again, which scares investors. So that is another dialogue that has to be encouraged with MNRE and SECI to ensure that they honor the contract and give those guarantees. Because the moment that comes in, I think credit risk itself will improve, which again will boost bank and investor confidence. So I could go on for about a couple more hours, but I think we'll move on.
I understand, as lawyers, you could go on for a couple of more hours, so you know, so that we will limit it to that. they could even charge speaking with them, so you know, let's not go. The next, thank you, Karan, for covering a couple of important points, which is, you know, bringing in the stability in the policy and regulation framework puts all a lot of problem for lenders, for IPPs, because we all see today we have a safeguard duty. Who knows when it comes down there will be an anti-dumping duty, and who knows there will not be any introduction of new GST regulations for solar sector. So we have all come out of those uncertainties and facing those challenges while, you know, while we prepare our financial models and Excel sheet and it all looks healthy, but certain of these things, apart from the risk what we take on the ground, which could be the receivable cycle assumed is 30 days and you don't get payments for 10-11 months, and those are not built in your model. And some of the other uncertainties, which was also covered in the morning, that the way we have been seeing and projecting the cost coming down historically, will it continue or not? So, and you know, without saying anything, for renewable round tripping has been a phenomena even for other infrastructure projects in India. But given the fact that the regulation is getting more stricter there, so I hope and wish we will not repeat the mistakes and then come in problems for renewable projects per se. When we are going doing large scale renewable projects and the amount of funding involved in that. So we will now go on and ask Tanya Sehgal, who is the founder at Solar Arise. She has a small presentation and we'll take that, and then after that I'll ask the other two speakers to provide their opening remarks. And given timeline, I'll request Tanya if she can limit that presentation to 5 minutes. Thank you so much.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Okay, so we are still alive, right? So what I wanted to do was, I wanted to give a small perspective of what we're talking about. Scale, right? We keep saying big numbers, gigawatts, megawatts. What does it mean? Okay, and I'll spend just 2 minutes on this and then we take it over the panel discussion. So when we say a 50 megawatt plant, you're talking about 200 football fields. 200 parallel football games going together, that's what makes a 50 megawatt plant. I'm talking about more than 2 lakh modules installed, more than 10,000 structures, almost 325 kilometers of cables. That's like almost 15 half marathons running. That's a 50 megawatt plant. We bid 350, 500 a gigawatt. That's the scale where we are in solar today. And what goes inside it is not one thing. There's a zillion factors that us as a developer community keep working behind rigorously to put them in play. You know, whether it's financing, payment, whether it's financing, payment, plant design, how the design will look like, what kind of structures will we take, what kind of debt will we have, what will be the revenue cycle. There are so many things that we have to put behind together to get it here. But everybody talked about profitability. You know, we talked about long-term sustainability. Let's look at what does a solar plant look like. And this is the reason why I wanted the presentation. If you see the orange line, that's the upfront capex we put in. You know, a large chunk of money we put in upfront. A large chunk of money we put in upfront, thinking to get good returns. At the end of the day, we are also here to make money as a solar IPP, right? We are doing this for the good of the society, but we also want returns on our plant. So the blue, the orange line that you see on the top is the money we put in. And if you see the early years in solar, does not give that much return to the investors. Why? Because most of the return goes to the bank to return the money. And then if you see as the return, the debt keeps tapering off, the return comes back to the investors. So solar is not a short-term game. It's a long-term vision. And that's what I want to urge everybody to think about. Yes, we've been in the sector for 10 years, but it's 10 out of 100. We have 30 gigawatt installed, but there's a 70 gigawatt coming over. And now we have come to a cusp where payment security is embedded in the business model. I am no longer going and requesting and asking for a 7, 8, 10 rupee PPA. I am providing power at lower than coal prices. The value proposition is inbuilt in it. The only mistake that we have to safeguard ourselves as a developer community is not to change this blue cash flows with the red one, which is a short-term perspective, where we'll put a little bit less money. So if you see the orange line becomes the red, a little bit less money upfront, thinking here we'll not put in as much capex in. You'll get the same cash flows in the start, but see where you'll go in the future. And that's the future we have to safeguard. All the choices that we discussed today in terms of profitability, execution, module plan, all of that comes with this judicial decision making. And that's where the key comes now for the solar sector. We have learned, we have built capability. Now is the point to put that capability to test. And as a group, maturely share learnings, together build, and be in a state where we are not just about megawatts, we are about megawatt hours, we are about the units we generate.
Well, I really thank Tanya. I mean, when she said I have a presentation and which is so crystal precise that we will not go look at an Excel and just one chart which says that, you know, your future cash flows and your LCO is more important than a dollar per megawatt what you spend right now. And what a precise way to present that in just one slide, which project that even if you reduce a little bit on the project capex right now. The only, you know, we are as developers also needs to bring in a little mindset change, which is agreeable that, you know, there are very few developers in the Indian sector right now who are building projects for perpetuity and who wants to stay invested in those projects for next 25 years. Most of them are building and thinking that will flip these assets to the next set of investor in next 3 years, 5 years, or sometime other private equity investor could think that this could be even before that. So a little mindset change from IPPs as well, and definitely we can, you know, there's no dearth of engineering talent to build good quality projects in India.